Season 1 has come and gone, and with it, the Colossus is sky high on a new adventure. In this episode, we recap the season as a whole and look forward to what's to come in Season 2.
Welcome to Sky Talkers. Here are your hosts, Charlotte and Caitlin.
Hello, and welcome to Sky Talkers. I'm your host, Charlotte.
Hey, everyone. I'm your other host, Caitlin, and welcome to our Season 1 Resistance recap.
Woo-hoo.
I love Resistance. I miss it, too. And I love it.
I know. And we're recording this on a Sunday, our usual recording day for Resistance. And it's just like old times, even though it's only been like 2 weeks.
So far away.
I'm so nostalgic for every Sunday Resistance coming out, honestly. When I wake up in the morning on a Sunday morning, I'm not like excited about Resistance anymore, and it makes me sad.
I know the feeling. Maybe we'll get something. Maybe we'll get something at Celebration.
Oh, we totally will.
I know. But like, maybe we'll, I don't know. Oh, also, Celebration, here's your daily reminder that we're going to be on the podcast stage.
What day again?
April 12th at 12.
High noon.
When the sun is directly above us in the sky. When there are no shadows. We will be on the podcast stage.
Exactly.
High noon.
April 12th at 12.
April 12th.
And you know what we're going to be talking about? I wonder what we're talking about, Caitlin. What are we going to talk about?
We're going to be talking about the episode 9 panel trailer. I don't. Will we be able to talk about it? That's the real question that I have. Someone brought this up on Twitter the other day. They were like, you need a projector screen so you can like rewatch it. I'm like, oh my God, you're so right.
I just don't even know how to go about doing that.
I don't know how to go about doing it either, but we definitely need it.
But we kind of do.
We can all rewatch it together. And I got to say, guys, just for our Resistance listeners, I was at Party City the other day and I got some fun tabletop decorations for our podcast stage. So please come and see those. They're not Resistance.
Really went for it.
I sent Charlotte like a crap ton of Snapchats and I was like, look at this. I'm buying this. This is ours. It's coming with us.
Were there any Resistance anything at Party City?
No, there wasn't. Resistance.
Was there any like Rebels things?
No. It was really just the sequel trilogy. That was it.
You know, don't you remember when we were younger and like we'd see the Clone Wars party stuff everywhere?
Yes. We threw a party with Clone Wars party stuff.
I know. We totally did. And it makes me kind of sad that their animation stuff isn't represented in, like, kids' party
currently.
Stuff,
I will say that, like, the Party City was very – I mean, I feel like all Party Cities are just, like, a little sad. You know what I mean? Like, they kind of have that vibe about them. Mm-hmm. Like, the candy's been there for, like, 12 months, but no one cares kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to, like, make it Party City's fault.
I'm not saying it's Party City's fault. It's surprising to me, and maybe it's just the market about like kids just want the sequel trilogy stuff. But in the past, I think the Clone Wars was pretty well represented in like the Target party aisle and in Party City and everything. And I don't think I've seen that for Rebels and obviously Resistance either.
I feel like those things really came up more in the like later seasons, honestly, even with Clone Wars. Maybe different with Clone Wars because it was the first animated show. Because I know that we had like first character model party stuff. You know what I mean? Like Ahsoka and the tube top was on the party stuff. So that was at least like up through season 3, I think. So I don't know. Maybe next season we'll get some. Because like Kaz deserves to be on a tablecloth. You know what I mean? On like a plastic tablecloth. He deserves it.
Agreed. He really does.
You know, like I sound jokey, but he really does deserve it. Kaz deserves the world. And that includes being featured on a plastic tablecloth.
So why don't we start talking about season 1?
Yes. So we're going to follow basically our same format as we did for our Resistance recaps, where part 1 is going to be our highs and lows.
And part 2 is our story.
And then part 3 is our characters. But we'll kind of be looking at it across the broader strokes of the entire season.
Exactly. So without further ado, let's get started.
So who talks first? You talk first? I talk first.
All right, welcome to part one, where we're talking about our highs and lows for this season as a whole. So Charlotte, why don't you go first?
So my first high as an overall is I'm just still so surprised and delighted with how they handled Tam's story. And I just can't get over the fact that we were so frustrated throughout the entire season. Not so frustrated, but generally frustrated throughout the entire season of like Tam not being let in on anything, Tam not getting her time in the spotlight, Tam just, you know, not being a part of Kaz's resistance plans. And it was all by design because Tam had to be left out of all that because she had to be given this devastating choice. And I just can't get over that they actually went there with this character because it's just, it's not where I expected it to go in the very beginning of the season.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this was almost one of my highs, but you wrote it down first. So, yeah.
Dang. It's just so good. Like, it's really just such a rich story.
Yeah, it was really nice to see. I mean, even just like the little tidbits we got mid-season of her perspective being introduced into the narrative of Star Wars and of Resistance, of, you know, her father was an Imperial pilot, or so he worked for the Empire, and then kind of what that meant for her down the line as it related to Kaz and all the secrets that were kept between them. So, yeah, I think it was really interesting, and I hope it plays a much bigger role in season two, which I think it will, since they had her make the choice to join the First Order. I think it has to play a bigger role in season two, so I'm really excited for that.
It totally is. I feel like it's, to be honest, like the juiciest thing about the end of the season.
Yeah.
I think that it just plays into what Kaz, I don't know, like I was just watching, you and I both were just rewatching the first episode, and just even the way that Poe like lays out his mission and like finding out who's loyal to the Resistance and who's loyal to the First Order. And I just don't think that Kaz would ever have expected that someone that he became friends with and someone who helped him and everything ended up not being loyal to the Resistance or loyal to Yeager and him. Mm-hmm. And I think that that is just – it obviously produces a really interesting conflict. And I do think that Tam will come back, but I can't wait for her to see the light.
Yeah. Yeah, me too. It's going to be so good.
It's so good.
There's going to be a lot of angst and a lot of pain, but at the end it's going to be so good.
So much. And I love it. I think it's so good. And I really love Tam's character, love the voice actress. I just think it's all really good. And it really was the highlight of the season for me because I'm just so surprised by it.
Yeah. Yeah. I am too. So literally my highs are the exact same. Why do we even have this section for me? My first high is Kaz. Just like across the board. I love him so much. I loved his whole character development this season, just watching him, especially going back and rewatching the first episode, just to see again how we talk a lot about Kaz's lack of hesitation and how that was present from the very first second he met Poe in episode one. But then how he was able to like develop skills down the line, but he's still just he's so funny and I love him so much.
He's just so good. He's just such a good boy.
And I forgot how funny the first episode is. The first episode.
It's really funny.
So funny. Like, even in the opening scenes when Kaz is talking to his R2 unit, I think it's R2, C3, something like that, or C4. And C4 is like, we have to turn around. I'm too young to die. And Kaz is like, you're too young to die. He's like, I'm too young to die. And they can't put me back together. It's just so funny.
Do you think that Kaz has like catapulted into your top 10 favorite characters?
Oh yeah, 100%.
Top 5 favorite characters?
He's either like 5 or 6.
Wow.
You know? Yeah. I just think
that's big.
I know.
He's so good. But I think that you're attracted to those kind of characters. Like you have you really love Luke Skywalker, and I think it's also because he's so good.
Yeah, it's funny because it's like Kylo is really like my only evil character that's up there. Because it's like, yeah, other than that, it's like Kylo and Luke are tied for my top favorite characters. And then it's literally like Ahsoka. And then I really like Obi-Wan. I feel like I'm going to, love Obi-Wan even more after Master and Apprentice comes out and we get to read it. And just, I don't know, it's something about Kaz. He's so relatable. I love his story. I love the flounders that he's had. I don't know. I just think it's really nice to have the time with a character like Kaz. I don't know. He's just great. He's great.
I agree. I think he's, I don't know. We'll talk about this a little bit later, but I think that his background and kind of everything that we've been presented with Kaz is just kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And like a different type of hero than we're used to. And
yeah,
we definitely have been on this journey, and he's come so far in season one that it's hard not to love him.
Yeah. I think too, because it was just so unexpected, knowing my Star Wars tendencies, to love a character who's not a Force user as much as I love Kaz.
Yes.
Because that is such a big part of like why I love Star Wars. I love the Force side of things. And the fact that that's like not at all in his narrative or really even on his radar, I think just speaks so much to how well they developed him.
Totally.
Yeah. Okay. So what was your second high?
So mine is really just – it's funny. I chose like story elements and you chose like a little bit more specific things. I just am also wowed by the fact that they continue – like the way they bump up against the timelines in – Resistance, like unabashedly, like to the point where it's not confusing and they don't really care if it is confusing. And it's like, I just love it. I think that it's, I love how they have been able to tell the story alongside of The Force Awakens to the point where it's not overt, but it still feels like this is connected to the sequel trilogy in a way, but it's also its own separate thing. I think they've really bridged this gap between the animation and the sequel trilogy, the films, in a really nice way through the way that they've like shown the timeline, you know, kind of bump up against each other.
Oh, yeah. The timeline is one of the coolest things about Resistance.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right. I think it's really great how they've been able to, yes, merge them, but they're also very separate. Like Resistance – and that's due in part to the setting of Resistance, but like the story of Resistance isn't controlled by what's happening in The Force Awakens.
Yeah.
It's obviously impacted by it, but.
Yeah, I think that sometimes Star Wars like novels and sometimes the comics are a little afraid to get too close to the films just because then it just creates some like canon issues. But I don't think that you see that in Resistance at all. I think that they've like taken the risk to go up alongside of The Force Awakens. And I just kind of wonder, like, is this confusing for kids? Do kids understand this? But I don't think at the end of the day, because they've done such a good job of developing the characters in this whole separate story, that it maybe just doesn't even matter. And it's just like it's a fun thing for us fans to be like, oh, this is where we are in the timeline. This is where we're headed. And it's so interesting that like BB-8's off with Rey right now and all these things. I just think it's so fun. It's just so fun.
This is a great opportunity for me to bring up a Dave Filoni quote.
Please do.
We haven't brought up Dave Filoni a whole lot because he's not as involved in Resistance. But do you remember, I think it cut going off of what you were saying about how sometimes the animation or the comic books or novels can be afraid to like touch the films mm-hmm. for like continuity issues and like that. Mm-hmm. But I remember Dave bringing up this really interesting point about the characters in Clone Wars and how he didn't want them to serve as a footnote to what was happening within the films. Yes. Like he wanted them to be able to operate on their own and be at the same level, like their canon adventures be at the same level as film canon adventures. I need to find the quote, like the exact interview where he was talking about it, because of course he explained it a lot better. Because that's the thing. It's like you don't ever want what's happening in Resistance to be solely because of what's happening in the sequel trilogy. And that was mm-hmm. Dave's whole thing with Ahsoka. And it's like Ahsoka doesn't have to die just because she's not present in Revenge of the Sith. Like mm-hmm. I can't – as a storyteller, he couldn't like operate within those rules or that mindset, because that would just really limit your storytelling capabilities. And I think that Resistance has done a really good job of that, of not serving as a footnote to the larger film stories.
Yeah, it's definitely something that quote specifically is something that I always have to keep in mind whenever I like try to theorize anything about mm-hmm. anything that comes forward in animation. Just because you're so right, like these characters aren't a footnote, but they can relate to our sequel trilogy heroes, but mm-hmm. they do have to stand on its own. And I think it's just really bold the way that they've done that here mm-hmm. because I always think about it, just to talk more about Dave Filoni.
Yay.
I always think about his constraints with the Grievous line.
Yes.
And if you don't know what I'm talking about, there's a line in Revenge of the Sith where obviously you guys know this, that Anakin has never met Grievous before. And because that was such an issue with Dave that he couldn't like play with this Grievous character and Anakin, because that would be, you know, so good for a conflict, but obviously he couldn't do that. And there's all these different scenes where they're like passing each other in like weird corridors and they always miss each other. And I think that in the very beginning, Dave always expressed like extreme frustration with that and being like, of course he misses Grievous, you know?
It's like, how many ways have we animated it for them to like not see each other?
Yeah. And I think that was like a major frustration of his. And I think that was something that they decided, I don't know, I think that like they're more careful in canon now for that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And Resistance is a really good example, because a lot of things can happen in Resistance that feed into the sequel trilogy, but, and like vice versa, but it never feels like, at least for me yet, it doesn't feel like they're kind of put into this constraint.
Yeah, and it doesn't feel Easter eggy. Either.
Exactly, which is something that we talk about a lot recently on the show, mm-hmm. where like you don't want things to be too Easter eggy, but you also want things to make sense in the canon timeline so that if you're a fan, you can follow it.
And it's a like fine that, line. It's a fine
it's a
line.
Really fine line, and I think that there's like arguments for both sides being good, mm-hmm. But it's really interesting, I think.
Yeah, what's funny about the Anakin situation from Clone Wars is that it's just this like. I can picture Dave perfectly in my head being like, it's just this one stupid throwaway line.
Yeah.
And it's Anakin says like, you're shorter than I expected. And he's like, and it's caused so many problems. It's really funny.
I think that they've like met over like hologram. Like they really worked on it throughout Clone Wars, and I haven't I've been so bad about my rewatch, and it's like leaving Netflix. Oh my God. But I think that they really
I can feel Danny judging us from afar.
I know. Our friend Danny also when he finished it.
Charlotte and I set up this whole amazing Google Doc for a Clone Wars rewatch last summer. And we invited our friend Danny into it, and he literally filled out the whole Google Doc himself.
He finished it.
And I just
got to like season one.
I'm ahead of you. Let me just say, I'm ahead of you. Anyway. But yeah, that like one throwaway line in because like Grievous is such a big character in the Clone Wars. Like he has to be. And mm-hmm. Dave was like, George created this huge character, and now I can't put this other huge character in any kind of close proximity to him.
So funny.
That's funny. But yeah, I think that that's a really good high too. So mm-hmm. my second high, which will also come as no surprise, is the Colossus. I love the Colossus. I love it so much. I really don't have a whole lot to say because I've already said it ad nauseum in literally 23 other episodes.
Caitlin is shipping herself with a ship at this point.
I've never loved a ship more than I've loved the Colossus. I just – like I love the setup of it. I love the microcosm that it represents as a storytelling piece for the show as a whole. I love how we've gotten to see it change and move, see it underwater, see different pieces of it. I love that the bar, the Aces bar, has a decorative backsplash to it, like an architectural tin, like a pressed tin pattern. It makes me really happy. And that's all
it's very good.
That's very good. And as we're going into Celebration, we talked about this a couple episodes ago, but how I want like a theme park style map of the Colossus. And so I hope that that exists somewhere. If you are listening and you find one at Celebration, please at me on Twitter and tell me where you got it and where I can get it to. I will pay money for it. Lots of money.
Incredible cross sections.
Incredible cross sections. And I really want like a theme park style map.
Yeah, it's super cool.
That's really what I want. So
the closets is so good. It is such a – and I think they know it's so good because they continued to use it into season two.
Mm-hmm.
Or else, like, if they didn't really like that set piece that much, I think that they would have just left it. But instead, it travels with them. It's everything. It is somehow larger than the TARDIS. But it's also, like – I think you're right about that, actually. That's a good comparison.
Thank you.
I think that, like, we all think about the ghost in Rebels being such a good setting and, you know, a tight quarters where it brings this whole, like, family together and everything. But the Colossus is almost, like, the opposite of that in that it brings people together, but it has all these different layers, and it's so metaphorical, it's just so good. So good.
It's, like, the Colossus is, like, a cross between the TARDIS and, like, Hogwarts Castle.
Yes.
You know, it like lives somewhere in the middle there. It takes like the goodness from each of those things and it just becomes its own special, amazing, beautiful Star Wars ship.
I would say it's more like Hogwarts than it is the TARDIS. But
yeah, now it moves like the TARDIS moves.
Exactly. So exactly.
Seeing it in hyperspace, wow, amazing.
So good. So beautiful. Good.
So beautiful.
So glorious.
Okay. All right. What's your low?
My low is I'm just pretty disappointed that the whole Bebo sea monster storyline didn't really come back in a way that I had wanted it to. I thought that whole story with Niku was such a good episode. It felt like a filler episode, if you will. But I had a feeling that it would come back, and I really just wanted it to come back in a bigger way, and it didn't. And now that we're off of Castellan, I don't really see it coming back. I know that we're going to get people who are like, yeah, but when they were, you know, shooting the stormtroopers off into the water, you know, their fate is that they're going to get eaten by those sea monsters. And I think that's true. I don't know if I really liked that. I thought that there would be something more.
I mean, never underestimate animation. I mean, the Purrgils from Rebels was a season two episode or something, and then it came back at the season finale.
So true. And, like, the Colossus could return to Castellan. Because
it can
like
move
that.
Now.
Yeah. So, yes, it can. But I really just kind of had, like, high hopes that, like, in the final battle that we got to witness in the finale that – you know, the sea monsters would like fight back against the First Order in a different way than like basically they did. I don't know. I was a little disappointed by that.
Hmm. Yeah, I wouldn't completely write that off yet.
I'm not.
Season one. Yeah.
I was ready for that to come back.
Yeah. Cause that nature versus like technology theme comes up a lot in Star Wars. So I wouldn't completely count it out yet. But yeah, it did kind of seem like the smoking gun. Like, they're down there. Are you going to use them or not?
Totally.
So my low for the season was the Aces. I was really ready to get to know all of the Aces pretty hardcore. And that didn't really happen at all. I'm still not even 100% sure on half of their names. which would have been fine, except I feel like the marketing really hyped the Aces. And like they all got their own like character design featurettes with like the voice actors and like, here's how we designed Hype and da 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 da. And Hype obviously had a little bit more screen time than the others, but they just all got shout outs. But then they had more time in featurettes than they actually had in the season.
It's like they're the Boba Fett / Phasma Resistance.
Can we stop with the Boba Fetts and Phasmas? Please.
No, it's like basically a Star Wars tradition at this point.
Or give me an interesting character like Lor San Tekka that I can like really dig my teeth into. You know what I mean?
We just need a couple of lines that like really dig straight into the Force mythology just to get Caitlin invested.
If you're going to die immediately – at least give me some folklore I can hold on to, okay? Otherwise, you're worthless to me. But that was a low. And then for me, we're going to talk about this later on in this episode too, but kind of how I feel like they really dropped Kaz's relationship with his father and this whole kind of complex father-son relationship they really seemed to set up in the first episode that really did not materialize at all throughout the season. And it was super interesting. Like rewatch, Charlotte and I were talking about it before we started recording, rewatching the first episode, they really lay it on heavy that Kaz and his father kind of have an intense relationship, but then they never brought it up again, really. So that was a little frustrating. And hopefully in season two, now that Hosni and Prime is no more, that could maybe change.
Agreed. I'm with you on both of those. I think the Aces, like, I never really cared, so I'm kind of glad that they're not a huge deal.
I usually have such a good radar for these things. Like, I never thought to care about Boba Fett. As soon as I saw Phasma, I was like, no. No. Like, I'm not investing any time in that character. Like, she's I wish we had – did we have the podcast then? Yeah,
before. We had a video.
We had a video.
Where we were unboxing a Funko Pop set.
Yes.
And we unboxed Phasma. It. And I was like, I'm so excited about Phasma. And you were like, I am not excited about Phasma.
I was like, she's going to be a Boba Fett. I think it's literally what I said. I said, she's going to be a Boba Fett. Mark my words.
And I was like, no. Okay.
So usually I have a pretty good eye for those things. But I just – darn Aces. The thing is, it's like, as for I love, like, main characters are all, like, I'm never going to stand like a side character over a main character. Like, I'm always very much invested in the main characters of stories. So I'm kind of glad that the Aces didn't end up taking away time from Kaz.
Agreed.
So, but it just frustrates me that, like I said, they had more time in featurettes than they had in this season. I'm like, why? So.
Okay. Well, let's talk about the story.
Yes.
So welcome to part two where we talk about the story. And usually I think we open with our what's to say to the Resistance, what's to say to the First Order, what's to say to the Colossus. But I think we already addressed that in past episodes. So why don't we start with like the big question of what's the overarching theme that season one presents us with?
I think the overarching theme that is continuing, I don't think it's been settled yet. And I think you said this a couple episodes ago, the theme that kind of sits on top of the sequel trilogy is this sense of belonging, or a theme of belonging, finding your belonging. And I think that that is a really big part of the first season of Resistance. I think it's something that hasn't been finished necessarily, or hasn't been like tied up at the end of the season. It's not something that I think is contained within season one. But I think that that is a big part of it, about Kaz figuring out, you know, what he's doing on the Colossus, about Yeager figuring out that his belonging isn't just, you know, an ex-rebellion pilot, even with Tora, and then with Tam. Like, Tam thought she had belonging, and then to her, it seemed like a lie. And so she sought a new place of belonging. I don't know. I think that theme is really prevalent for all of our characters, and even with Sanara too, like where she belongs. It's something that hasn't been defined for any of them yet, I don't think completely, but will be in the upcoming seasons.
Yeah. And even just, you didn't mention Neeku, but in the first episode, Neeku says, you and I, Kaz, you and I, we have a common goal. You want to be an ace pilot, and I really want to get to the top of the Colossus. Yeah. And I think that he is getting there. And I think that, like, that sense of belonging, even just working together, is something that Neeku needed. Because I imagine Neeku didn't really have that many friends. And I just think that that's, like, that's something that Neeku needed to realize that he wanted. And I think that, like, even just him steering the Colossus and having that ability to do that is also him finding a different sense of belonging. And I think that that's probably the number one theme of Resistance. And I think it's really cool that it's the number one theme, because it is the number one theme of the sequel trilogy as well. And if this is the same era, I think that you could also say that, like, belonging obviously comes up in the original trilogy as well. Like, Luke is obviously on a constant search for belonging. And I think he finds it in the rebellion and with his sister and with his friends. But obviously, that's a tough journey. But I think that the sequel trilogy, more than anything, is really about belonging and just having the hope that someday you will find and never be alone. And I think that that's exactly what the Resistance is like setting up in a different sort of way than the personal way that the sequel trilogy is. Yeah, I think Christopher Sean said that he thinks Resistance is about hope. And like, of course it is. What Star Wars piece isn't about hope? But I do think that it's mostly about belonging.
I think it's great because the theme of hope is, I mean, that is the theme of Star Wars. So of course it's a theme in Resistance. And then so is the family and belonging, I think, too, at this point, especially in the Disney era. But what I love about Resistance is that the characters are always, save for a few, the characters are always like unabashedly positive about their situations. It's kind of what you were saying earlier about how like I really love Luke because he's such a good character, like a good person. At least like the piece of his life that we see in the original trilogy. Of course, that changes later on that we're still getting information on. But like Kaz is the same way. Like Kaz is unceasingly optimistic. And like so is Tora and so is Niku. And Jaeger and Tam represent kind of a different side of that. But I think for like Kaz, that's such his strength, is that even when the chips are down, he's like, no, this is fine. Like we're all still alive. It's like, that's good, right? Okay. Yeah. He's like, let's plan the next thing. And I think that that's so great because that really does, I mean, it ties in perfectly to what Christopher Sean said about there always being hope. And then to have people like Kaz who are coming into leadership positions, that's really imperative for them to have that, to be able to pass that along to other people. And we see that hope and that positivity get passed on to Jaeger, I think, in particular, throughout the season, to the point where at the end of the season, Jaeger is like, no, like, Kaz has got this. Kaz is going to come for me. We're okay. Like, we're in good hands. I love it.
Me too. I think that I was trying to think about this in relation to the Clone Wars and Rebels, because I think that those are clear comparison points in terms of like the animation department at Star Wars. If Clone Wars is about, you know, all the different sides of war, from the horrors to the friendships to rebuilding communities, and Rebels is about the found family and I think Rebels is generally about found family. I think that's the number one.
Yeah.
I think Resistance is honestly somewhere in between that. And I don't think we've seen like the war side exactly yet, just because we're still in the Cold War of the First Order and in the New Republic. And of course now we're really not, because the way that the season ended. But I think that like we will eventually get to the rough parts that the Clone Wars really kind of showed us about. I think that I'm just even surprised with like the grueling details of like the First Order destroying Ayla and Kel's planet, and then just witnessing the destruction of the Hosnian Prime. I think that like that will only escalate because they're going to have to deal with those repercussions in season two. And because of that, I don't think we've gotten that like Clone Wars part just yet. But I think that we are found family. It definitely is a huge part of Resistance. I think that that like can't not go unsaid.
Yeah, I think you're right that it's something that, one, I don't think we can say definitively yet because we've only just finished season one.
Yeah.
But I think you're right. Like, I think it does live somewhere in the middle between like that theme of Clone Wars and Rebels, because like I think the Rebels crew was so focused, or the Rebels show was so focused on that found family component, and like them all supporting each other and like being there for each other emotionally, and like that was such the centerpiece of that show. Whereas with Clone Wars, I do think that centerpiece was the war itself, and then I think Resistance like lives somewhere in the middle there, because I don't think Resistance, not that it won't, but it hasn't yet had that kind of deep relationship building that Rebels kind of did out of the gate, I think. And you're right, because we are in kind of the Cold War stages and our the Colossus was very removed from the center of the galaxy, we weren't really seeing all the sides of war that I think we will see going into the future. Mm-hmm. So I think it'll be interesting to see where it does end up.
Yeah, I think that, like, Clone Wars is in a really unique spot because of the way that it was structured in the arcs and everything. Like, we would bounce around between, mm-hmm. you know, this Ahsoka and Anakin episode, this only Ahsoka episode, one with Obi-Wan and one with just the clones and everything. And we have not seen that in Resistance. And honestly, we barely saw that in Rebels too. And I think that as the war escalates and they're going to fill in that time gap, I guess, between if there is a time gap between episode 8 and 9, then I think that they're going to have to take us around and kind of give us a little bit more background about, like, what's going on in the war. And I think that maybe that's where we'll see certain storytelling elements like the Clone Wars come into play. But I still don't really know. I think that, like, it's really interesting because I think that if you compare, like, the character structures of Resistance and Rebels, you know, in Rebels we had, like, an actual relationship between Kanan and Hera. Mm-hmm. And, like, that's obviously a romantic relationship. We have, like, essentially no hard romantic relationships in Resistance just yet. I think that we've had, like, some flirtatious stuff with, like, Sonara and Kaz and everything. But I think that, like, the family relationship that maybe we can link to is the relationship between Tora and Captain Doza. Mm-hmm. And, like, that in itself is a really interesting relationship because we don't really know 100% Doza's deal, and we are kind of fully trusting of Tora. So, like, will that relationship break down? What does that even look like? Because here they are now on the Colossus together, and now they know stuff that, like, they didn't know before.
They know stuff.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that, like, the found family just looks a little different because there's not that romantic element. They are all at this point, like, on the same page about a lot of stuff too. Like, I don't think a lot of the Rebels family was on the same page about some things right in the beginning. I don't know if that makes sense.
I mean, yeah, because, like, Kanan and Hera, like, Hera was always much more ready to join the rebellion than Kanan ever was.
Yeah.
So that was a source of tension between them. But where Rebels kind of had, I guess, more of a benefit for that was the fact that they were all on the Ghost, what we said earlier, that they mm-hmm. were in this, like, really tight space. So you mm-hmm. had to work out your problems with each other. Whereas the Colossus is different because I remember we talked about at the beginning of this season about Jaeger and Kaz coming to have a comparable relationship to Kanan and Ezra. And they didn't really go that route at all, which I think it's fine. Like, it's nice to see it kind of change. But that was a complete flip on what our expectations, I think, were. Because I think mm-hmm. we were expecting it to become a Rebels-type found family. But it really hasn't at all. I mean, like, Tam is gone. Tora is, yes, connected with them, but not really. Like, she's more connected to her father. Tora has, like, no relationship with Jaeger. So it's like they're more of a web, like Resistance mm-hmm. is more of a web of relationships, and then Rebels yes. is more of like a, I guess, like a cluster. But again,
not even a cluster, like they're just really tight.
Yeah, they're like a tangle, like a knot, like a knot,
a knot,
a knot. whereas Resistance is more of the web, and then like Clone Wars is completely different because you really just had it was like Anakin, Obi-Wan, and Ahsoka and Padme, and it was them going off in various formations of that group to have adventures. But I think it'll be really interesting to see if that web in Resistance kind of does condense itself into a knot by the time the series is over. Mm-hmm. Whereas I think Rebels really did kind of start out that way because Ezra was the only new person into the knot. And mm-hmm. they just kind of like engulfed him.
Right.
In a good way. Mm-hmm.
So maybe, like, this comparison just isn't even right.
I think it's good to talk about it because
yeah.
it is – I mean, it's our other animated shows. Of course, we're going to compare them. But it's nice to see that, like, it's good that Jaeger and Kaz didn't have a similar relationship as Kanan and Ezra had because we've already seen Kanan and Ezra have that relationship. Mm-hmm. So it's nice. I like seeing it be different and having the opportunity to talk about why they are different – specifically, I think is really beneficial.
I don't even think that Yeager is essentially the same kind of mentor that Kanan was for Ezra.
Yeah, like, no, not at all.
Like, I don't even think you can really, I think that they, there's some things, like perhaps Yeager's reluctance to go back into the fight is potentially the same as Kanan's, like in a weird way.
Yeah.
But I don't think that, like, they're, you know, master-apprentice relationship is really there, because it's just not, like, they're not Jedi.
No, it's not. I think we thought it might become something like that, though, because Yeager knew Poe was a mechanic, like, was basically Kaz's only point person who knew who he really was.
Mm-hmm.
And then that didn't really end up happening at all, because now I see them more, like, I feel like Yeager views Kaz more of an equal now, mm-hmm. From the last episodes, of just how much trust he put in Kaz at the end. Whereas right. Kanan and Ezra were kind of always within that master Padawan relationship.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it totally is. So where do we think season two is going to go?
Where does our pot of spaghetti?
Yeah, where is the Colossus going to go? What's happening?
Well, that's the question, isn't it? Where is the Colossus going? No one knows.
I think the Colossus is going to go to the Unknown Regions.
We're just going to have to, like, staple the Last Jedi novelization.
Jedi novelization, essentially. Yeah. I feel like the fact that, like, Niku has no idea where they're going, like, if they show up at a familiar system, it won't be that satisfying to me. Like, I think that them being, like, in a strange place that they don't really know, like it's off the map or something like that, would be really interesting, because then it would take them out of The Last Jedi, like that whole thing. They wouldn't be able to get the communique from Leia and on Crait and everything like that. And I think that, like, they could encounter, who knows what they could encounter out there.
I think it'd be fun for them to end up somewhere like on Coruscant. And to just, like, dive headfirst
cool too
into whatever the political situation is going on there. Especially if Kaz is now the surviving son of a senator of the New Republic, mm-hmm. assuming that Kaz's father died on Hosnian Prime. I mean, who knows if he'll
have... Do we think his father died?
I don't know. I don't know. I think maybe he did.
Here's the thing. If we're going to compare Rebels to Resistance, we have already seen our hero grapple with thinking that his parents could be alive and then realizing that his parents actually died a long time ago. And yeah. I feel like that is, like, something that we've already dealt with. Like, it was a huge learning moment for Ezra, whatever. But whatever. I think for Kaz, it might be good to have his father still be alive, because we know that there's, like, some lingering tension between them, and it's obviously something that we want to see continued.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I guess it would be good if his father was still alive and then maybe was trying to recruit Kaz into whatever was being left of the
Republic. Yeah, I think that, like, the First Order destroying Hosnian Prime is already a catapult for Kaz to be more invested in the Resistance, which he obviously was. But I think that him having this personal connection makes things real for him. Like that line from
Rogue One, suddenly the rebellion is real to you.
Yes, exactly. And he needed that moment. And I think that, like, it was like play pretend kind of on the Colossus until it wasn't. And I think that that's almost good enough, in the fact that if his parents were alive, I really do think that it would be more established conflict. If they're not alive, I think that, like, it would be good conflict anyway. But I think that if they survived, I think it actually might be good.
Yeah, I think talking through it would be good if Kaz's father was still alive. Because in the first episode, Kaz's father says, you know, oh, you're with those extremists, the Resistance. Mm-hmm. So he doesn't like the Resistance. And so my guess is if he is still alive, he probably still has a negative view of the Resistance and wouldn't want Kaz to be a part of it.
Or now he doesn't have a negative view of the Resistance because he watched it destroy his home. He watched the First Order destroy his home.
Yeah, I think the conflict is more interesting if Kaz's father is still not interested in the Resistance. But I could be wrong.
But him, like, even coming into the fold about, like, understanding the fight, I think would be valuable, because I think in a way Kaz's father could be a lens to how we look at, like, the general citizen of the galaxy who doesn't understand this, like, Cold War that's happening between, like, this unsanctioned army from the New Republic and, like, this huge new threat of the First Order.
Yeah, I don't know if Kaz's father would be a good example of that, because he is a super wealthy senator who obviously has knowledge.
That's not really what I mean. Like, I don't mean he's like the every person, but I do think that it would be a good understanding for
someone who's, like, outside of those organizations.
Yeah, or like maybe just like even too invested in politics to even understand like the real world of like what's happening.
Yeah. Ugh. Hashtag where's Ezra? Hashtag where's Kaz's father?
I don't know. Where's Kaz's mother, too?
Right?
Because, like, I want that as well.
Does Kaz have siblings? Does he have any pets? Like,
oh, my God. Does Kaz have siblings? I bet he's an only child.
Can you imagine Kaz with a little sister?
He has big only child energy.
You would know.
I would know.
I feel like if Kaz does have a sibling, it's a sister, though.
That would be great. I love that. I love whenever, like, Rebels did that with Sabine's family. I love when they introduce, like, a random sibling that we didn't even know existed, and kind of tells like so much more about, like, their childhood and how they view the world. Love it.
It does. Kaz definitely has a sister, though, if he's not an only child.
So in terms of the spaghetti metaphor, I think that, like, the spaghetti metaphor is, like, done, right? Because we've served the pasta.
No. We just serve the pasta, like, when we're eating spaghetti, because, like, who just wants to stop at the boiling water, like, in the real world? But the pasta metaphor extends for the whole sequel trilogy. Like, eating the pasta is episode 9.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know where we are exactly. But, like, season 1 of Resistance was boiling the water, and then The Force Awakens was putting the pasta into the water.
Okay.
And so right now we're pasta and water stirring every couple minutes.
Okay. Got it.
That's makes where we sense. Are right now. So it depends on how much time, because Last Jedi is draining the pasta.
Uh-huh.
Oh, so maybe we've drained the pasta.
I think we've drained the pasta.
We've drained the pasta.
And now we're saucing. We're figuring out what's going on top.
Are we doing a pesto? Are we doing an Alfredo? Like a nice meat sauce? What are we doing?
You know, a good marinara.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm hungry.
All day simmering.
Homemade meatballs.
Wait, now I'm hungry.
Okay, yum. Ooh, freshly grated Parmesan.
Obviously.
A little bit of basil.
Yeah, that's episode 9.
That's episode 9. But, like, it takes a long time. That's why there could be a potential time leap between Last Jedi and episode 9.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's where we are. We're at the saucing stage right now, I think. Depending on – I don't think we'll get any time in Resistance that's definitively tied to the Last Jedi days, which is the draining the pasta stage. So – we're at saucing.
I think there's two things that actually we'll probably get that are directly lined to The Last Jedi. One, maybe some sort of message that, like, they've evacuated Dakar. Two, and, like, there's no place for them to go. Two, not getting Leia's signal, or, like, trying to, you know, return Leia's signal and, like, not being able to, because, like, wherever the heck the Colossus is, that doesn't reach there.
Yeah. So we're somewhere in between draining the pasta and saucing the pasta.
Yeah.
Sounds about right.
Right. Do we think that the Colossus has potential to show up in episode 9?
I hope so, man.
I think that if, like, the Resistance comes back swinging with, like, a bunch of new ships, and which I feel like they're going to, because they're going to win this war. Like, it's Star Wars.
Spoiler.
I think that, like... it would be so cool, just like we saw the ghost in Rogue One, but it would be so cool to see the Colossus, like, somewhere, you know, around.
Yeah, yeah. I would definitely be okay with seeing the Colossus anywhere on the big screen. I would freak out. So
It would be so cool.
Let's go. Let's get it. I'll come on to our show and be like, I don't know what happened with Kylo and Rey, but the Colossus was on screen.
So that's all I cared about. No, that's oh my it. God.
Can you imagine that? It'll definitely be in my top 5 moments of the movie, though.
I don't know. Like, mark your words. Let's talk in December, because I don't know about that.
What if they went on the Colossus?
That would be cool.
That'd be bananas. That would be bananas. We'd have to, like, if that happens, we would have to commit to, like, bringing pasta into our next viewing of episode 9.
I mean, that wouldn't be the worst thing that we could possibly do.
No. Or we'll go to, like, one of those dine-in movie theaters and order pasta.
Ew. I hate dine-in movie theaters. Not my fave. I mean,
they're not great, but yeah. Whatever. We just have to have pasta.
All right. We'll bring like a pasta salad.
A pasta salad?
Yeah, you know. All right, we got to stop talking about pasta. Let's move on to talking about characters.
Part 3.
Listen, big deal. You got another problem. Women always figure out the truth. Always.
Okay, welcome to part 3 where we're not talking about pasta, but we are talking about characters. So let's talk about my fave some more. Let's talk about Kaz. So based on episode 1 to the finale, where exactly has Kaz gone?
So it's crazy because Caitlin and I were rewatching the first episode, which is 40 minutes, which I just want to amend. My low for the past like 2 episodes has been – it should have been an hour. Like, the episode should have been an hour. And I realized that they used their hour card, essentially, for the first episode. So I just want to apologize to the creators of Resistance for me kind of dragging that, because they used that for the first time. I don't know why I didn't – whatever. It's fine. Anyway, I think, where has Kaz gone? There's no better description for me to understand how far Kaz has come than in the very first scene of Resistance – Kaz is being chased by Major Von Reg, and he can't shake him. The whole team can't shake him, and Poe's like, I'll do it for you. And he, you know, blunders his ship, and his ship is on fire and everything. And it's a mess, basically. And by the end of the first season, Kaz was able to fight back against Major Von Reg. And I may have some issues with the fact that he killed Major Von Reg, but he did kill Von Reg and was able to kind of move on from that and kind of show his growth through this moment. And I think that that was like super powerful if you just watch these two back to back.
Well, what's crazy is that in that first episode, when Kaz and his friends are trying to deliver that information to the Resistance, Kaz is the leader in that group, because he says that one, they're all freaking out, and he tells the other two, he says, all right, you guys go back, I'll stay here. And he goes, that's an order. And I'm like, oh, I had forgotten that. And I was like, wait a second, Kaz was a leader in the New Republic Navy? Okay.
Yeah. He's a big wig.
Yeah, I guess so. But I guess that was because of, like, his father kind of put him there, is kind of what I'm thinking more now. And so to see him still have that lack of hesitation in episode 1, but it's so much more refined by the end of the season, and he's right a lot more of the time, is just really satisfying. But that Kaz hasn't really changed as a person. He's grown, but that idealism that I think he had at the beginning of the season is still there. It's just a little bit more experienced now. But he's still the same Kaz.
Yeah. I love him. Let's talk about his relationship with his father, which we've obviously touched on already a couple times in this episode. But I think it's really interesting when he tries to – when Poe, you know, recruits him into the Resistance and says, I think I have an eye for these things. And Kaz is like, what? Okay. he's like, oh, let me – I just have to call my dad. So he scrambles the code and we can't see the father at all. And – The call just doesn't go that well. He says, like you mentioned, he says those extremists, and he basically like hangs up on his dad. Then he walks out and he's like, I'm in. And the way that Kaz says, you know, my father is a senator and he has sort of this whole plan for me, I think is really interesting, because here Kaz is deciding to go against that plan because someone else believes in him. And I think it's this like real state of rebellion for Kaz, even though I don't really think that's like extremely explored in the season. But if you just look back on how this character started and where he's gone, I think that he is almost dealing with his, by watching the destruction of Hosnian Prime, I think he's dealing with the repercussions of his rebellion, of like going into the resistance basically against his father's orders and against his father's plan, even though that's what he wanted and it's his own personal choice, which again is a huge Star Wars theme. Mm-hmm. So I don't really know what to make of that, but I do think it's like it's one of the most interesting conflicts that has ever been in Star Wars, in my opinion.
Yeah, but it just kind of falls out after the first episode.
Yeah,
because they really do kind of lay it on thick in the first episode. Mm-hmm. I mean, his father goes through this whole list of things that he has had to help Kaz with. And Kaz just kind of stands there and is frustrated. And like you said, just hangs up on his father. And then it's like, all right, time to go. And I was also listening back to our first review of the first episode of Resistance. And the whole time we're like, well, this father thing, it's definitely going to come up again.
It's the most interesting thing.
I know, we're like, it's so interesting. We're like, is his father going to end up being the First Order spy? Is his dad going to like come to the Colossus and not know that Kaz is there? Or maybe he's going to be with the First Order? Like, we had all of these crazy headcanons ready to go. Mm-hmm. And nada.
Nada.
Nada. The big old goose egg. And I think because this was one of my critiques at the end of the season two was how Hosnian Prime was handled in the initial explosion, I think in part one of the season finale, mm-hmm. is that the emotion didn't hit, I think, as hard as I wanted it to, because something like this had been dropped. And I mean, I'm going to say her name wrong. Captain
Tierney.
Tierney. In my head was like Tyrion. Tyrion. That's not it. Stop, Peg. That's not correct. When she's telling Tam about Kaz, she's like, yeah, he's super wealthy, like came from a really good family, a senator. Like, she's even bringing up all these really interesting points. And Tam is like, good God, that's interesting. And I'm here like, yeah, it is. Why haven't I got more of this throughout the whole season? So maybe that line, though, you know, my father is a senator and he has this whole plan for me. Maybe his father is alive now and will be coming back, because it's like, oh, now's the chance for me to insert my own family now that there's no rebellion or no resistance and New Republic. Mm-hmm. And maybe kind of try to manipulate Kaz into some kind of leadership position there. But I don't know. Watch, we're spending all this time talking about the father and he's like never going to come up again.
I really want him to, though.
I do, too. I think it's so interesting, like, having a super wealthy kid that's, like
– I know.
The only character I can think of that kind of has that background is Lux.
Yeah. Oh, man. We get so much Lux hate, I feel like, every time we bring him up.
No, we don't. Lux is such a good character. Heroes on Both Sides is a pinnacle of Clone Wars. Like, you can at me all you want, listeners. I will stand by Lux Bonteri.
You know, I don't think Kaz is like the typical rich kid. And I think that's a really bold move. Like, this show doesn't fall into any of those tropes, like, that are just so frustrating.
I think Kaz was that typical rich kid, literally until the first episode of Resistance. And that's when everything changed. Because, I mean, I keep praising his optimism and stuff like that. But part of his optimism is the fact that he's never really had any challenges because his father has been handing him everything along the way.
Right.
Uh-huh. So I think Kaz is that typical rich kid, and like this whole thing on the Colossus is what Lux's adventures on Onderon were in season four with Ahsoka and Saw and Steela. It's like that moment. I think they're comparable anyway. But I don't know. Yeah, like Lux is the only character that we've seen kind of from a similar background that we spent any time with, and Kaz is much more of a main character than Lux was. So there's so much richness there that I really hope gets explored. That's why I think it would be kind of fun if they went to like a planet from the inner core.
Me too. I don't know. I kind of stand by my own theory.
I mean, that's
that yeah, I'm so intrigued to see where we go in season two. So, who are your top three favorite characters?
Kaz, Tora, and Poe, actually. I really liked Poe in Resistance. I thought
I'm really shocked that Poe is in your top three.
I know. I was too. I thought long and hard about it. Let me tell you. Kaz and Tora were easy picks. But I think that Oscar Isaac did such a great job in it. And I really liked – I don't know. I thought it was really interesting getting Poe's opinion on things throughout the season and, like, the things that he would teach Kaz. Like, I'm kind of always thinking back to that moment when he's telling Kaz how to shoot a blaster. And he's like, it doesn't matter if you don't know how. Like, you got to learn because they're going to shoot back at you. Mm-hmm. I always think that was such a really interesting lesson. And I don't know. I think that Poe did a good job in this season. I think they used him well throughout. I don't know. I really enjoyed him. And Tora, I just – oh, God. I love Tora. I love her voice. Like, her voice actress just, like, makes me happy. I love how smart she is. I love how she, like, more or less figured out what was going on with Kaz. And, like, I kind of ship them. So
yeah, same. I just think Tora is so good because she's so smart. And I think even just her intro with, like, I mean, her introduction was, you know, Kaz choosing to race her because he was like, oh, she's just a, you know, a young girl, the newest person. She's a newbie. Mm-hmm. And everyone was like, ha, 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 I can't believe you chose her. And it was so funny because it was like, I don't know, Star Wars has this, like, great tradition going now where every person, like, underestimates the girl and then the girl, like, comes out swinging. And I think that Tora is just so good because she was totally on it about Kaz being, like, involved in the resistance and, you know, in a large part. And she knew all these things and she's just so nice and all these friends and I don't know. She's just great. She's really a joy to watch.
Her room was amazing. Buggles was so weird and creepy, but also really lovable. And I love their episode, Kaz and Tora's episode, I think kind of mid-season, where they end up in the laser trash compactor. It's like a step above just a regular trash compactor.
That was so good.
It was really good. It was fun, too. And like, that was, I think, a good – that was, like, Easter eggy, but that was, like, a good use of an Easter egg.
Mm-hmm. So my favorite three characters were our Kaz, like we mentioned, Tam, like I also mentioned, and Yeager, because I love everything about Yeager. And I think that his character is only going to get more interesting. I think he has, like, this really cool backstory, like, what's the deal with his family? That one photo that we saw in that one episode, like, what is mm-hmm. that? That's still a question we don't have answered. And just even after watching the movie The Right Stuff and knowing that Chuck Yeager is the inspiration for this character of Yeager, and even just, like, watching that and, like, understanding that and knowing that Yeager's going to get, like, back into the fight, and then watching that episode where he races his brother and that, like, they have to break that record, that's essentially what Chuck Yeager in real life did, which is, like, burst through the sound barrier. You guys should watch The Right Stuff if you haven't. It's so good. It's, like, 4 hours, but it's amazing. And just that has, like, given me a lot more, like, understanding of where they're going to take Yeager as a character, which to me, it's, like, no surprise that he would find himself back into the fight. But also he is someone who with, like, a storied history of, like, in the rebellion and, like, what is his life? Like, I need to know because I'm sure it's really interesting. I also really love the voice actor. I think that he, yes, you know, brings so much to this character. And like we mentioned, I think that Yeager is, like, a different type of mentor than we're used to. And, like, maybe he's not even a mentor at all, but he is someone who Kaz can look to for he is a mentor, but, like, he is someone that Kaz can look to for, like, stories of the past, which is a character that we don't necessarily have in Resistance. And obviously something that I'm, like, really interested in as someone, and as fans are, as someone who understands, like, the history of Star Wars. And, like, I want to see what Yeager has to say about his time in the Rebellion.
Yeah, I think that's one of my favorite things about Yeager. It's, like, I just want to hear what he has to say. Like, I want to sit with him at Auntie's bar, have a couple of drinks, and just, like, hear his story.
Yeah, I think that, like, it would be super cool if Yeager knew Poe's parents. Like, I was rewatching the scene where they, you know, saw each other again in the first episode, and mm-hmm. it's, like, because Poe's parents were part of the Rebellion, they were close with Luke and Leia and Han, and Poe, like, kind of grew up in the Rebellion. And I think that, like, if there was any sort of crossover with that, I think that that would be really interesting, because it would also ground this character and his family in another time period. And I don't know. I'm really interested in that.
Yeah. Yeager is – yeah, I think it's right not to even call him a mentor anymore, but he's someone that Kaz can count on when the going gets tough. Mm-hmm. Especially now, from what we see kind of develop of the relationship at the end of the season. I hope that it'll be interesting to see him in season two, now that he's one more pro Kaz, like trusts Kaz more and is kind of like he's back in it for better or for worse. So kind of how that expertise is going to be utilized in season two, I think will be really interesting to watch, because I think it will be, because Poe is busy. So Poe's not really going to be there as much. At least I don't think he will be. So Yeager will kind of be that point person that's had the experience with the rebellion and the Empire.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think are the most meaningful relationships that have come out of Resistance so far?
This is such a tough question, because
I think it's so easy.
Really? Because I have like a couple of answers.
Clearly, it's BB-8 and CB-23.
Well, see, that's funny that you say that, because I was going to say it is potentially BB-8 and Kaz. But then I'm like, it's probably not. Because I don't think that BB-8 feels the same way about Kaz. But I think that in a way, Kaz, like BB-8 was like Kaz's, you know, lifeline to the Resistance. And I think that was like so important for Kaz to have.
I don't think that any droid has initially loved Kaz when they first met him, because even in the first episode, I mean, that R2 unit that Kaz is with is like snarky with him. That droid and BB-8 are both snarky with Kaz when they meet Poe for the first time. The droids that Kaz meets in Aunt Z's bar on his first time there, they don't like him. I don't know what it is, because I love Kaz.
I think, like, jokes aside, probably the most, like, meaningful relationship is what Kaz was able to accomplish with Sonara. I think that, like, him just even being able to bridge those barriers between basically the Colossus and the pirates. Like, now the pirate ship is part of the Colossus, which I know is going to cause some conflict going forward.
So cool.
But, like, that's not something that would have ever happened before. And, like, just even having the pirates to be able to help them fight back, all of that is because of Kaz's kindness towards Sonara and, mm-hmm. like, her belief in Sonara. And, yeah. like, because of that, they wouldn't have been able to escape the First Order without the pirates' help. And that was something that, like, we wouldn't have been able to foresee in the very beginning when the pirates were continuously attacking the Colossus. And truly all of that is because of Sonara and Kaz.
Yeah. I think this question will have clearer answers moving forward into season two, because after kind of talking through the differences between, like, Clone Wars, Rebels, and Resistance, and kind of describing Resistance more as a web rather than mm-hmm. a knot, I don't think Resistance has really delved super deeply into these relationships yet. I think they've been formed and they're strong, and obviously this group of people is loyal to each other, but, like, Kaz hasn't talked about his father with anyone yet. Doza and Tora haven't talked about her mother with anyone. Like, there are still these, like, really big things and emotional pieces that haven't really been explored yet. And I think that's because it's season one. And we're still, like, this is still the beginning, right? Isn't that crazy? I mean, at this point, like, Tora and I think you're right. Kaz and Sonara did a lot as far as, like, forming a new relationship that has a lot of implications down the line. I wonder if it'll come up again with Tora and Kaz watching how they watched Hothian Prime blow up. Because Tora was really there for Kaz in that moment to be like, yes, you can be sad, but we also have to go. So I really loved that moment between the two of them. And that was, for me, that was like, one of the most emotionally heavy moments in the show for the whole season. So that kind of stands out for me. And like Tam, like part of her story was about being left out. So she wasn't having those kinds of conversations with the other characters, because like they knew that she was going to be leaving with the First Order at the end of it. So like she kind of had to be left out. So I think this question will be really interesting to talk about again. I think we'll talk about it at the end of every season, but moving into season two especially.
Mm-hmm. I hope there's like 7 seasons of Resistance.
I love Resistance.
Actually, I say that, but I also really like
love
that.
A compact story.
I love a compact story so much.
That you can just put on a shelf, like a
shelf,
book.
So I can like put it on a shelf and just like close the book.
And it's like a compact story that I just put on the shelf.
I love that. So like maybe 4 seasons. But I do hope that Resistance just continues and continues to like – and have – and isn't like canceled, basically, is what I hope.
Don't even put that out there on the podcast.
I'm not. I just like wanted to have like its good ending. It's
yeah,
full ending.
I do too. I think it will. I think.
Me too.
I would be really surprised if they're like, well, 2 seasons, we out.
It has like such a high rating on Rotten Tomatoes, mm-hmm. at least the critic score, which is just bodes so well. It's like, I think at like a 99 because it is so good.
So good. I mean, like the lows and stuff that we've talked about, I feel like have been rather nitpicky.
I mean, how many episodes have we been like, no lows, it's just good?
Yeah, a lot actually. Yeah. And I think a lot of people too that maybe didn't watch Resistance at first were kind of one waiting to binge it mm-hmm. once the season was finished, but now maybe after Celebration they'll be like, oh, this looks good. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah,
I think even it is. Even just by the fact that the Resistance panel isn't on the main Celebration stage, like, shows that it is kind of a smaller audience than kind of maybe that they were expecting, but like it's just a smaller audience in general. And I think that it will only grow, because I remember back at Celebration 5 in the Clone Wars panel, and that was like season 3, right, Kaylin? Like something like that.
It was on
a smaller stage.
Yeah,
it was like in the second or third smallest stage, and it was fall, but it was still like a small group of people. And I think that like that's how Resistance will grow as well, as people get more attached to and like you even see Rebels. Like Rebels now was on the main stage last year or last time. So I think that it will just only grow.
Yeah, I think Lucasfilm knows that with the animated shows, like it takes a season or two to like really warm its way into people's hearts. Just because people like want to binge it, watch it slowly, aren't ready for it, or whatever the reason is, it just takes people longer to get invested in a TV show than like a movie, I think, sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I'm really excited. I hope we get to see some more of Kaz. Maybe we'll find out where they're going.
I think we will.
That
I think,
would be a good reveal.
I don't know how they're going to like keep that hidden by showing like new scenes from season 2.
Well, if they're all just on the Colossus.
Yeah, you're right about that. But that's not very visually interesting.
I don't know. You know? The Colossus is pretty visually interesting.
Oh my God. I'm so ready.
I feel like you just insulted the Colossus and you need to take a step back.
I mean, one location? Come on.
The whole season has been on one location. What do you mean one location? The whole season has been on the Colossus. You do
counter argument. No, it hasn't.
We've been on the pirate ship. We've been like, it's the bulk of season 1 has been on the Colossus. You're being nitpicky.
I am being nitpicky. I'm trying to convince myself that we're going to see more. That's what's happening right now, is that I'm just trying to convince myself that we're going to like see big spoilers.
No, you made a mistake, and we're like, that's not visually interesting. The whole season is more.
I insulted the Colossus. How dare I?
Literally, though. When
I love the Colossus too. Okay.
Doesn't sound like it.
I do,
Charlotte. The Colossus is not visually interesting, Arity.
That's not true. It's not true.
Okay. Well.
Anyway, I think that's going to bring us to the end, right?
Yeah, to the end of the line for season 1. And we will be prepared
for such a good season.
Oh, man, it was really good. Resistance surprised me in such a good way, and it's forever in my Star Wars heart. I'm ready for a Colossus theme park style map that I can purchase and hang up. I'm ready for Kaz, just like in general. No specifics, just Kaz. And for all that's coming with it. So Thank you guys for listening to all of our Resistance recaps. I hope you've had a good time. Also, I don't think we got a chance to say this, but seeing everyone's hashtag Skytalkers spaghetti pictures.
Amazing.
From the finale. Like, when I tell you how happy it made me so happy.
Amazing. Really so great. Thank you guys for, like, making the pasta, sending us the pasta. It was so great.
I can't believe people, like, made pasta.
Me too. I mean, because it's, of not Resistance. It's not the hardest thing ever to make. So
okay, it's not. It's pretty accessible. Like, someone was like, I'm going to have pasta because of Resistance and because Skytalkers came up with this, like, dumb metaphor. And, like, now it's a thing.
It was amazing. It was the best thing ever.
Yeah. It was really – it made both of us really happy. So thank you for everyone who did that. Whenever you're watching Resistance and you just feel the urge to have some carbs and want to make some pasta, you can always tag us or hashtag it, hashtag Skytalkers spaghetti. So please do that. But – that is going to wrap up our season one Resistance recap. Thank you guys for coming along for the ride. We'll be back for season two. And if you want to gush about Kaz or give me the reasons why you still think Neeku is the First Order spy, you can find us at the podcast stage on April 12th.
Oh my God.
And we can chat about it then. So please come. But until then, you can find us online at Skytalkers Pod or our personal handles at Caitlin Plusher or at Crarity. We also have a website, skytalkers.com. You can visit us there. And if you like what you hear, then head on over to iTunes and leave us a review so other people can find our show too.
Yes. And I want to thank our amazing patrons, Jason, Kelly, Kimberly, Amy, Neil, Mary, Larry, James, Sarah, Susanna, Z, Cherie, Angela, Diana, Becca, Lynn, Katie, Courtney, Brian, Amy, Kelly, Jim, Swara, Irina, Vundacast Productions, Christian, Adam, Megan, Courtney, Centara, Thomas, John, Dominic, Megan, Kate, Matthew, Fernanda, Chell, Manny, David, Claudia, Kate, Brooklyn, Lady Valkyrie, Jenny, Blessed Cheesemaker, Danny, Lump of Aru, Patrick, James, Hamsa, From a Certain Point of View, The Dorky Diva Show, Megan, Stewart, Kyle, Jennifer, Kells, Chastity, Elia, Travis, Katie, Daniela, Alyssa, Rebecca, Andy, Delaney, Angela, Ali, Natalia, Daz, Serene, Shireen, Jordan, Molly, Aaron, Scott, Ira Bell, BJ, Casey, Lauren, Tom, Edith, Connie, Robbie, Kirsty, The Clashing Sabers Podcast, and Chuck. Thank you guys so much for supporting us. Your support truly means the world.
Yes, thank you guys so much. And until next time, may the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.
Skytalkers is a member of the Star Wars Escape Pods Network. Explore more great content and get to know our sister shows at weareescapepods.com and on Twitter at @weareescapepods. The Star Wars Escape Pods Network, promoting positivity in fandom.